Hey guys, how's it going? Welcome back to FizzWiz. I'm Manas Sharma, and in this tutorial, I'll be showing you guys how to calculate the radial distribution functions from AIMD trajectories obtained from a VASP calculation. So, in very brief, a radial distribution essentially gives you the density of the particles at a given distance r from a reference particle. So, and in other words, you can also say that it's kind of a probability. And the radial distribution functions usually look something kind of like this, as you can see in this plot over here. And as you can also notice that they differ for the different kinds of chemical systems that you might have. So if you have a solid, then you can see that the radial distribution curve looks like this blue curve, which has well-defined peaks at some sort of intervals, and between those peaks the radial distribution function goes to zero. And so that is how one would expect it for a solid, and the reason being that in solids you have a regular and regular arrangement of atoms at specific distances. So let's say if I have an atom here, then the nearest neighbors would be at some distance r, right? So that is what you will get from the first peak. So the position of the first peak will give you the distance of the nearest neighbors of my reference atom. Then the second peak position will give me the distance between the reference atom and the second nearest neighbors, and so on. While in liquids and gases, you can see that it is not decaying to zero as r increases, but rather it's just slightly oscillating about one and just decaying to one. And the reason is that first, of course, you have a slight peak in liquids and gases, but that is mainly giving you the information about at what distance the nearest neighbors are for my reference atom. But once you start going away from it, these atoms and molecules are so uniformly distributed that the probability of finding another atom at a given distance r is always equal to the probability of finding another atom at some distance much larger than r as well. So it's like essentially giving you the local structure information. So that is why it is also said that these RDFs give you the information of the local structure, nearest neighbors, coordination numbers, and so on. So yeah, so that is I guess enough chit chat about the RDF in general. And now the topic of this tutorial, as I mentioned, is how to calculate such a plot. So here I will be using the AIMD trajectory for a solid, that is the molybdenum solid crystal. So I would expect a plot that looks kind of like this. So yeah, so let's go ahead. So I have already performed a calculation of for the molybdenum denim crystal with, I think, 54 atoms in the unit cell at a temperature of 800 Kelvin. So I did an NVT simulation, and now I have all these output files. So the trajectory file is the XDATCAR file, and although you can also do it using the OUTCAR file as well, or even other formats may be possible. But yeah, so the topic is how to do calculate RDF using VMD from the VASP trajectory file. So the next thing that we need to do is we need to open VMD, of course, and we need to import this file. So let's go ahead and click on file, new molecule, browse, and so I have it here. So I will import this XDATCAR. Determine the file type to be XDATCAR 5 for some reason. XDATCAR doesn't work for me, so I'll then go ahead and load it. Now as you can see, you can barely see any atoms here, so let me just adjust the graphics and representation style. So let me go ahead and choose CPK, which usually looks fine, but there are still minor adjustments that I would like to make. So that would be, I would like to enable PVC box by opening the terminal of VMD. So whenever you launch VMD, it opens three windows. You have the dialog box from which you open the file, then you have this terminal, as well as the rendering box where your structure is rendered. So yeah, so now you can see the trajectory in 3D much nicely. And also let me go ahead and choose the orthographic display option. So yeah, so this particular calculation, I did it for 5,000 steps with a time step of 1 femtosecond, so I have like 5,000 frames. They are still being loaded up. And in the meanwhile, I would like to also tell you one more thing that I forgot to mention. So this, you know, broadened structure of the peaks of the solid RDF also basically comes from the motion, this thermal motion that you're observing right now. So that is what gives rise to this peaks. So the more is the temperature, the more the atoms are moving, the broadened the peak would be. So yeah, so let's see. Okay, so we are very close to VMD almost reading the entire trajectory. So just waiting for it to happen any moment now. Oh, it done. So yeah, so now it has read the entire trajectory. Now you can scrub over it very smoothly and very quickly. So you can see this thermal motion happening, but it's not breaking apart or anything like that. It was done for just 800 Kelvin. So yeah, so now is the moment of truth. Now how to calculate the RDF. So you'll go ahead and click on extensions, then analysis, and then head over to radial distribution or radial pair distribution function. And then first thing you need to do is you need to select the molecules. In our case, it would be the XDATCAR file that we have imported over here. And next, we need to provide the reference atom from which the distances would be calculated. So that is a bit tricky. You don't just say molybdenum, but rather you say name space molybdenum. And then in our case, it's just molybdenum. So the second atom type would also be MO. But if you have a multi-atom system, then you could also use other elements. And yeah, then you have the frame. So for how many of these frames you want to calculation to be done. So zero means that you're starting from the first frame. Last frame right now is -1, which basically means that it's another way to denote the last frame if you don't already know the total number of frames. And then the step size is 1. So in order to make this calculation fast for this tutorial, let me go ahead and set the step size to 20 at least. And yeah, so the remaining things, yeah, max R basically means this R axis parameter over here. So like how long or like how farther from the reference atom we need to calculate this radial distribution function from. So yeah, so now you can just go ahead and click on compute G of R. It might take a moment. Yeah, so it's now done. So there were 250 frames in total with my settings. And yeah, so here is what it looks like. Now let's have a look and see if we can like analyze it or really find out why does it look like the way it does. So for that, I have opened the boss car, or rather the con car actually, in my Investa. And let me adjust the windows a bit. So from this, okay, I can do that. But yeah, okay, so from the radial distribution function that we see over here, what you can see is that the first peak is at about 2.7 or something, right? 2.7, 2.75. And the second peak is at about 3.1 maybe, yeah? So these two things we know for a fact. And then we know that, okay, so this is 2, this is 3, this is 4. So the next peak is at like at 4.5 or something, right? So let's see if we can see such distances, such neighbors in our system. So let's go ahead and select the distance calculation tool. So yeah, so one of the closest distances that I'm seeing is along this diagonal. So yeah, so the distance comes at about 2.7 angstroms, which is actually in good agreement with what we saw in the RDF as well. So yeah, all these distances are like 2.7 angstroms. So yeah, so this makes sense that the nearest neighbors are 2.7 angstroms apart, and there are perhaps more of these because the peak is higher. Next, let's have a look at the horizontal distances. So let's have a look at this. So this is like 3.25, and then this is 3.31, and then this is 3.02. So yeah, so that also again makes sense that we found the next peak to be like somewhere around 3 angstroms, right? Slightly higher than 3 angstroms. Next, let's have a look at the vertical distances. So this distance is like 4.34 angstroms, and this distance is 3.13 angstroms again. So this will contribute to the second peak. And yeah, this distance is again like 4.34. So this is again contributing to the third peak. So yeah, so it all makes sense to me as I can see it, that this 4 angstrom peak is of course shorter because we are not seeing that many occurrences of these distances and so on. So yeah, so yeah, so that is basically it for this tutorial, I guess. So I've shown you how to calculate the RDF from a VASP AIMD trajectory using VMD. I hope you guys enjoyed this tutorial and found it useful. In case you did, then don't forget to hit the like button and subscribe to my channel for more videos like this. Thanks for watching and have a great day.